first I statement is simply this: I am committed to knowing the Lord better. Now, this is an experimental worship service, so I need you to say it with me out loud on the count of three. Ready? One, two, three. I am committed to knowing the Lord better. Men and women of God, one of the first things we learn about God in this text is who God is. You see, when you look at the text as written, when you see the name of God here in Hebrew, it is the name Elohim. You see, the word Elohim appears in the very first sentence of the Bible. You see, there are many names of God that are present in the Old Testament to help us understand who he is. That's why we say that he is Jehovah Rapha, or we say that he's Jehovah Jireh. We're talking about his power. We're talking about his strength. And so those names speak to that. But in Genesis, we have Elohim, which is a reminder of the fact that the one who is talking in Genesis is the one that began it all. The one that is talking in Genesis is the one that created the heavens and earth, separating light from darkness. The one that is talking in Genesis contains a concept that there is a creator that has not some power, but has all power, all authority, and all sovereignty. In other words, the literal translation for the word Elohim means this: the strong one. In other words, it has to do with both God's sovereignty and his authority reflecting his great power. Let me see if I can unpack it this way. A commitment to knowing God better will change your life because you understand that the strong one who has authority, the strong one who has sovereign power is on your side. The more I know about God, that this is who I am statement kicks in. I am committed to knowing God because in the season that I am in, I need to know more about the strong one. I need to know one about the one with all authority. I need to know more about the one that rules and super rules, because there are some days on this journey where you will feel forsaken and you need to call on the Lord for a breakthrough. You need to call on the Lord for a miracle. Now, it is Black History Month, guys. I'm going to remind you of what Langston Hughes said about it. In the light of the fact that we are talking about building this year, I was taken to that old school poem by Langston Hughes entitled Mother to Son. Langston Hughes simply says this. He's talking about a building project, and he's talking about stairs, but he's not talking about no crystal stairs. He says, well, son, I'll tell you, life for me ain't been no crystal stair. It had tacks in it. I wish I had some folks that have some tacks on your staircase, and splinters, and boards torn up, and places with no carpet on the floor bare. But this is what the mother says to the son: but all the time I've been climbing on and reaching landings and turning corners. I wish I had some folks that have been turning some corners. And he says, and sometimes going into the dark where there ain't been no light. So boy, don't you turn back. Don't sit down on the steps, cause you find it kind of hard. Don't you fall now, for I still going, honey. I still climbing, and life for me ain't been no crystal stair. Well, if he didn't do it for you in that powerful form, let me take you to a scene on that old rugged cross when Jesus, the Son of the Living God, called on Elohim by name. You heard it when he said, Allah, Allah, lama sabachthani. He said, my God, why hast thou forsaken me? What is Jesus doing? He's calling on the strong one who has authority to help him in the middle of his situation. I wish I had some folks that knew the power of calling on the strong one who has authority to help you in the middle of your situation. But guess what Jesus teaches us about this thing called life? He teaches us that sometimes it gets a whole lot worse before it ever gets better. Because even though he called on Elohim, guess what happened next? He died. Despite the fact he was calling on the Lord, he still died. And guess what happened next? After he died, they pierced him in his side. And guess what happened after that? After he died and they pierced him in his side, they buried him in a borrowed grave. You talking about things getting worse before they got better. But guess what happened next? All the haters in hell started to celebrate. Satan thought that he won. The imps thought they had the victory. They thought God was defeated. But guess what happened next? Let me see if I can unpack it for you this way. Men and women of God, the more that you understand about God, the more that you will realize that while you are going through, that sometimes it's going to get worse before it gets better. But if you've been studying this word, if you've been talking with Jesus, you recognize it's a detour on the path to your destination. The naysayers will say that they got you. The critics will look at you funny. The haters will talk real bad about you. But just like Jesus, S.M. Lockridge told us something. I may be falsely accused on Thursday, but Sunday is still coming. You may crucify me on Friday, but Sunday is still coming. You might spit on my grave on Saturday, but Sunday is still coming. And when Sunday gets here, we can get up with not some power, but all power in our hands. I wish I had some church folk who understands that your Redeemer lives, and because he lives, you can face tomorrow. Because he lives, all fear is gone. Because I know he holds my future, and my life is worth the living just because he lives. Men and women of God, men and women of God, let me tell you something. You got to remember that. I am committed to knowing the Lord Jesus.